Danton. Whatever else it was about Danton which incited Robespierre's enmity, his coarseness made the incorruptible skin crawl. Sick, one day, of Robespierre's vaporing about virtue, Danton scoffed with vulgar raillery. "There's no more solid virtue than what I do every night with my wife. How can a man to whom every idea about morality is alien be the defender of liberty?" Nevertheless, Danton made a last attempt at reconciliation. He went to see Robespierre, but his nerve was gone. He came without poise. His petition was one of despair, and Robespierre knew it. Danton implored him to put aside the whisperings against him of Collot and Billot, former associates. "Let us forget our differences and consider only the needs and interests of the patrie." Unity was what counted, harmony and consensus within France. The divisive politics of terror had shattered the common agreement about liberty. Let them work to bring the people together, not continuously to drive them apart by punitive laws. Once the Republic is respected beyond its borders, men inside its borders will love it, even men who now work to undermine it. Robespierre brushed the appeal aside. "Someone with your principles and your morals would never find any criminals to condemn." "And would you regret that? Would you be sorry not to find any criminals to send to the scaffold?" Danton had asked for the release from prison of 73 deputies with indulgent sympathies. Robespierre refused point blank. "The only way to establish liberty is to cut off the heads of such criminals." Danton burst into tears. Robespierre's anger was surely laced with contempt for this man before him, once so large a presence in the revolution, now crumbling like a woman. He noted later that Danton made himself ridiculous with melodramatic posturing and tears. Danton tried to embrace him as he left, but Robespierre shrank frostily and remained as cold as marble. Robespierre had already compiled a dossier of notes on Danton. These he passed to Saint-Just as the basis of a charge sheet. Of the man he had once called friend, he wrote, "Danton never spoke with energy on any subject other than himself. His silence during serious discussion can be explained only by his big physical size and his indulgence in sex." Danton himself had already expressed his weariness with the internecine feuding. He was under no illusions about his own fate. A few days before Robespierre delivered his indictment, he and Danton attended the performance of an obscure tragedy at the Théâtre Français. A member of the audience recalled that Robespierre sat in a box. Danton sat in the stalls in company with a large group of his friends. When an actor spoke the line, "Death to the tyrant," Danton's friends stood up and broke into wild applause, then turned to stare at Robespierre and shook their fists threateningly at him. Robespierre went pale, his face twitching nervously, swaying like that of a snake. He waved his small clerk's hand in a gesture expressing his fright, but menace too. Danton was urged to escape while he could. Like Socrates, he refused. "You do not wear patriotism on the soles of your shoes," he said, and rebuffed any suggestion that he might mount a campaign to overthrow Robespierre. It would mean more blood, and there had been too much shedding of blood already. "Yes, it is time to break the scythe of death. Better to be guillotined than to guillotine." What Saint-Just said was true. The practice of government produced nothing but monsters. On the evening of the 30th of March, Robespierre called an emergency session of the two committees whose combined signatures were required for the issue of an arrest warrant. 20 men attended. Saint-Just read out the deposition he had prepared, demanding the arrest of Danton and Desmoulins. Landais, of the Committee for Public Safety, in charge of subsistences, refused to sign. He was there to feed citizens, he said, not to put patriots to death. So did Rulle, of the Committee for General Security, loyal to his friend Danton. Carnot, surely mindful of the many times Danton had unleashed that great roar of his, "The patrie in danger," to stir the people and to its patriotic defence, deliberated before adding his name. He warned the others to think long and hard. a head like Danton's will bring down many others with it. The warrant, drawn up on a sheet of wrapping paper and signed by 18 members of the two committees, was issued. Later that night, the civilian municipal officers, wearing the holy tricolour sash of their authority and accompanied by patrols of gendarmes, thumped on the doors in the Cour du Commerce to arrest in the name of the Republic and the people Georges Danton and Camille Desmoulins. Rulle had sent a messenger to forewarn Danton. He found him sitting in an armchair by the fire. He evinced no surprise and showed no inclination to avoid what he saw as the inevitable. He was resigned. When the patrol arrived, heavy hobnail boots clattering on the stone paving of the street, Danton went to wake his wife. "They've come to arrest me." She wept. He kissed her and told her not to be afraid. They would not dare kill him. They took him to the Luxembourg, where he was joined by Desmoulins, who bore up strongly enough when taken away from his wife and young son. But once in prison, his stoicism gave way to a tourbillon of emotions. The shocking news of the arrests broke next morning. Danton? So many had claimed to speak for the people, but Danton's voice bore the unfeigned accents of a real man of the people. And Desmoulins, who had called for a new spirit of clemency in the Republic? Danton's belief that they would not dare kill him was widely shared. Yet, having arrested him on whatever trumped-up charges, how could they conceivably risk an acquittal? In the convention, Danton's friend, the sans-culotte butcher Legendre, came to his aid. "Citizens, last night certain members of this assembly were arrested. Danton was among them. I demand that the members of the convention who were arrested be brought to the bar of this assembly to be accused or absolved by us. I am convinced that Danton is as pure as I am." Legendre was even bold enough to hint that Danton was the victim of certain private hatreds. This evoked scattered, perhaps tentative, cries of "Down with the dictatorship!" Tallien, president that day, was about to put Legendre's motion to the vote when Robespierre entered the hall and hurried to the rostrum. He stared round at his audience, letting his eye rest for the space of two heartbeats on those whom he mistrusted. A deathly stillness hung upon the room. Robespierre lowered his green-tinted spectacles, and in what must be taken as a defining moment of the terror, he turned on Legendre. The accused were, he said, ambitious hypocrites. Legendre has spoken of Danton apparently because he believes some privilege attaches to this name. No, we have no desire for privileges. We will see this day whether the convention knows how to break an idol for so long false and corrupt, or whether in its fall that idol will crush the convention and the French people. He stared fixedly at Legendre through the thick sea-green lenses of his spectacles. "I say that whoever trembles at this very moment is guilty. Innocence has never feared public scrutiny. Danton's friends have pestered me with their arguments. They believe that the memory of a former liaison will make me soften my zeal and my passion for liberty. I say to you, no such motive has grazed my soul with the slightest impression. I was Pétion's friend. As soon as he was unmasked, I cut with him. I also had links with Roland. He committed treason. I denounced him. Danton wishes to take their place, and he is, in my eyes, nothing less than an enemy of the patrie." There was a heavy silence. The blood drained from Legendre's face. He stammered, "If Robespierre thinks that I am capable of sacrificing liberty for an individual, he mistook my meaning. Those who have proof in their hands know better than we do the guilt of the men who have been arrested." At 7 p.m. the decree of accusation was adopted. Lumped in with Danton and Desmoulins were a number of others accused of peculation and fraud, and a general accused of cowardice. From the Luxembourg prison, Desmoulins could see the gardens where he and his beloved Lucille had so often walked. He wrote to her. Seeing them recalls so many memories of our love. Then I fall to my knees and stretch out my arms to embrace you. Again, I sleep, and heaven takes pity on me, for in sleep I am free once more. A moment ago I saw you as in a dream and held you in my arms again. I married a woman of celestial virtue. I have been a faithful husband, a good son. I would have been a good father. I enjoy the esteem and the sorrows of all true republicans. For 5 years I have walked along the precipices of the revolution without falling into the abyss. I rest my head in tranquillity on the pillow of all that I have written, all filled with the same compassion and the same desire to lead my fellow citizens to happiness and freedom. If only it were true. But he, as many others, had been infected with the same bile and aggression which so embittered the struggle between opposing factions. Still, Desmoulins spoke for many in a quite different way. He voiced his own pangs of misery at parting from the woman he loved, and thus voiced the terrible sorrow of thousands riding to the scaffold on mere pretext. Oh, my darling, my Lucille, we will be together again. Can this death which delivers me from witnessing such crimes be a misfortune? The shores of my life recede. I see you again, Lucille, beloved. My bound hands embrace you, and when my head falls into the basket, my dying eyes will rest upon you. After only 2 days in the Luxembourg, Danton and the rest were transferred to the Conciergerie, death's antechamber, and the trial began on the 2nd of April. In the Conciergerie, Danton expressed his regrets. I leave everything in an appalling mess. The entire government is completely at odds. In the midst of such insanity, I'm glad not to have put my name to certain decrees. People will know I wanted nothing to do with them. Not one of them knows the first thing about government. A pity I can't leave my balls to that eunuch Robespierre and my legs to the cripple Couton. But Robespierre will follow. I will drag him down. The proof that that bastard is a Nero. He never spoke to Camille Desmoulins in such terms of friendship as the day before he was arrested. In revolutions, authority rests with the worst criminals. They're fucking animals. They'll be shouting, "Long live the Republic," when they see me go past. 2nd of April, 1794, 10 a.m. The Great Hall of the Palace of Justice, where the Parliament of Paris used to meet. Gilded ceiling, marble floor. The tapestries stripped from the walls, the carpet embroidered with the royal fleur-de-lis rolled up. The king's throne and Dürer's painting of Christ gone. At the wooden table which serves as a bench, the judges, and at a small table in front of them, the public prosecutor, Fouquier Tinville, all garbed in dark clothes and hats with black plumes. To the left, chairs and a table for the 7 jurors only, the most dependable of the dependable. The rest of the room and corridors outside packed with spectators craning for a view, ears pricked. When the prisoners were arraigned, General Westerman asked the court president Herman to be included on his old friend Danton's indictment. When Herman replied that that was a mere formality, Danton chimed in that their very presence was a mere formality. Asked for his place of residence, he retorted, "My home will soon be in nothingness. My name you will find in the pantheon of history. Danton, an aristocrat. France will not believe that for long. Me? Bought? A man such as I cannot be bought." Whilst he could not be bought, he had certainly had no compunction about taking money. It's what they did under the old regime. It's what men in any sort of government did, and at worst no more than a peccadillo. In truth, the oil that lubricates the machinery of government, whatever form it took. But whereas Robespierre had always been known to be incorruptible, unmoving in his principles, Danton had swayed in the breeze. He called for terror, and 3 months later wanted no terror. His principles were tailored to the moment. He summed himself up. "Let my reputation perish before that of my patrie." France's honour before Danton's. In that indifference, at least, there was no posturing. Asked his age, Desmoulins replied, 33, the same age as the sans-culotte Jesus Christ when he was crucified. Fouquier, the public prosecutor, and Herman were well primed. A frontal attack on Danton would expose the flimsiness of the case. They concentrated, rather, on those accused of fraud, a lengthy report which consumed most of the first day of the trial. Whenever Danton tried to interrupt, Herman rang his bell furiously to drown out his voice. "Can't you hear my bell?" he cried. Danton scoffed. "A man fighting for his life laughs at bells." The dread moment arrived when Danton was called to account and must unleash his stentorian voice. "Danton, you are accused of favouring the traitor Dumouriez and sharing his plots to murder liberty by marching on Paris with an army to destroy the Republic and to re-establish royalty." Danton launched in. The voice which had so frequently spoken for the people would brush such calumnies aside with ease. He called on the convention to set up a commission to investigate the dictatorship he would denounce to them, a dictatorship he, Danton, would unmask. Herman took fright and tried to call Danton to order. "Your audacity is the hallmark of crime. Innocence remains calm." But Danton was not to be checked. How could he rein in his indignation when such unjust charges were levelled at him? Once more, Herman intervened. It was not by insolent attacks on his accusers who enjoyed public esteem that he would convince the jury. Danton roared back. "A man accused as I am being accused does not answer to a jury. I stand before it and I defend myself, slandering no one. I have never acted through ambition or greed. I have devoted myself to the patrie and I made the sacrifice gladly. Now I must speak of three base cowards who have perverted Robespierre, and here I will reveal important facts." Herman cut him off. The various accusations were advanced one by one, and Danton rubbished them in turn, lambasting the deceit, the malice, the total lack of substance contaminating them. The crowded courtroom applauded. This was the best prize-fighting they'd seen in a while. The big fellow Danton wading into the high and mighty judges in their hats and sashes and giving them a rare pasting. There were even rumours that he might be acquitted. The so-called evidence against him was so ludicrous, so flagrantly outside any legitimacy. At one point, Herman scribbled a note to Fouquier, informing him that he was going to suspend Danton's defence in half an hour. When he did so, Danton met the illegality head-on and declared that he might as well forfeit any thoughts of rebutting the charges. They cheered him long and loud. However cheered it was, he knew that they had long since torn such holes in the law that it could never be any kind of safety net, not for him, not for anyone. They would all inevitably plummet down through the gaping loopholes these justices had cut in the law, once the safety of the people. Turning to the bench, he, as it were, translated for them the clamour of the crowd at his back and said, "The people will tear my enemies into pieces within 3 months." Fouquier and Herman were losing grip of the trial. Fouquier announced that the court was being made mock of and he intended to submit the judgment to the National Convention. That meant, in reality, the Committee for Public Safety, dominated by Robespierre. He told them that the accused are behaving like madmen. They call for witnesses. They appeal to the people and ignore our refusal. In spite of the resolution of the president, their incessant demands are causing disorder and disruption. They simply will not be quiet. We ask your advice. Our judicial powers are not adequate to what we are being asked to do. The Committee for Public Safety and the Committee for General Security had made contingency plans. A letter from one Laflotte, a prisoner in the Luxembourg, was produced in court. Lucille Desmoulins had been observed in the vicinity of the prison, carrying their infant son Oas in her arms. She was known in her despair to have sought help for her husband from a number of people in Paris. Laflotte's letter revealed the existence of a plot among the Luxembourg prisoners, drummed up by Danton and Desmoulins to overthrow the revolutionary tribunal. By order of the public prosecutor, therefore, the trial was suspended until the convention had deliberated. The conspiracy had been unmasked, the conspirators identified, and, to Camille's horror, Lucille Desmoulins named as its leader. Once more, the Committee for Public Safety had come to the rescue of the Republic in danger. In the convention, Saint-Just called for a law which denied every accused person who resists or insults the national justice the right to plead a defence. The convention passed it. Ammar of the Committee for General Security took the notice to Fouquier and told him, "This should make your job easier." Danton vilified them. They were murderers. They had not called a single witness. They produced no documentary evidence. Were the accused to be sentenced without a hearing? But he was crying out solitary in the desert. In the manic jangling of Herman's bell, it was over. David of the Committee for General Security cried out, "We've got them at last!" And Herman ordered the prisoners to be returned to the conciergerie for immediate execution of the sentence, which was to be read out to them in the prison. For form's sake, he read it to the empty benches like a bored priest mumbling the first office of the day in a vacant church. On the way to the Place de la Révolution, Desmoulins, in an access of nervous distraction, cried out to the crowd as if a protest of innocence could deliver an act of last-minute pardon. "They lied! They are killing people who served you! My only crime is to have wept!" Danton calmed him. "Quiet now. Pay no heed to that vile rabble." The "they" of Desmoulins' lament were stool pigeons of the mob lining the route. Danton knew it. Robespierre, with his apostrophizing of the noble, the holy, the sovereign people, would never dare consider the blasphemy of it. They were taken in three red-painted tumbrils. The route skirted the café where Danton had met his first wife, past the reptilian David sketching his condam friend Danton as the cortège went by, the Duplay house where Robespierre lived, its blinds drawn. They reached the scaffold at about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. The crowd watched in silence as, one after the other, they mounted the steps. The turnkey in the conciergerie was right. It was big game today. Hérold de Seychelles went first. He turned to kiss Danton. The executioner pulled Hérold onto the steps. Danton rebuked him. "You won't be able to stop our heads from meeting in the basket." Desmoulins went third. Danton last of all onto the abattoir of a scaffold over which had poured some 5 gallons of fresh blood, spouts from severed necks. The platform and plank onto which the victims were shoved awash with gore, the spray spattering those who waited below, the steps drabbled with the overspill. In the 20-odd minutes of the blade's work, the rusty reek of lifeblood infecting the ghastly altar of the revolution. They say he nearly broke, muttered involuntarily the aching sadness of leaving his wife behind, but suddenly reproved himself, told himself to hold firm and stepped up head high, and knowing that only the head of somebody notable would be held up and flaunted, behold the head of a traitor, bid the executioner, "Make sure you show them my head, it'll be worth it." His body and head joined the 17 others in the cart. A little over a week later, on the 13th of April, Lucille Desmoulins made the same journey with 18 others, including Hébert's widow. Lucille wrote to her mother a brief, poignant last note from the conciergerie. "Good night, dearest mother. A tear falls from my eye for you. I will go to sleep in the tranquility of innocence. Lucille."